Well, good morning, Cooper City family. It's so good to see you today in this house of worship. Amen. I want you to take your Bibles this morning. Go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. And if you would, just go ahead and find that in your Bible, your phone, whatever it is you use to look at the scriptures with. Also, you can go to the Cooper City Church of God app. All of my notes from today will be there on the Cooper City app as well for you to follow along with me. After the service today, if you're one of our senior adults here in the house today, our senior adults have a table back here, and they're giving away a free gift to our senior adults today, a free Valentine's gift. So you don't want to miss out. I got a feeling we got more senior adults in the house today than we normally do. That's going to be admitting it so they can get that gift on their way out today. And they've got plenty for you. So make sure you stop by there and pick up that gift on your way out today. As I said earlier, this is the week we celebrate Valentine's Day. So gentlemen, how you doing? Are you ahead of the game? Have you already, ordered the flowers, bought the chocolates, made the reservations? If not, you're behind the game, man. You got to step it up. And ladies, same with you. It's not just all on us, right? Come on, guys. It's not just on us. Everybody has to do their part as Valentine's Day approaches. And you would think that since this week is Valentine's Day, that I would just continue to talk about what we talked about last week, what Anthony and Shannon did such a great job doing, talking about marriage. But actually, this morning, I want to talk to the singles in the house. Boy, that was a pitiful response right there. I got one amen that sounded like it was back in children's church somewhere. Amen. Now, I noticed that my first crowd this morning, I noticed that quite a few of them were a little bit quiet. And so a few of them came to me after church today and said, "Pastor, we wanted to encourage you. We wanted to say amen, but we're married and we're afraid our spouse might be, thinking you're not happily married. You mean you want to be single too?" So I understand today, married couples, I understand if you're a little quiet today, I understand why you would be so. But you know what? My heart really does go out to our singles. And, about 50% of our church are single. We saw that at the end of the first service today, when I gave the invitation at the end for all the singles to come up to pray over them. And I think there was probably about 40 women and 3 guys. So single guys, if you can't find a lady here, I mean, come on, the odds of 3 to 40, come on. Now I understand ladies being frustrated. You mean we've only got 3 to pick from? That's it. So if you're a single guy, let me tell you something. You in the right house today. You're in the right church this morning. But I want to talk to you today about God's word to singles. And that doesn't mean that there's not anything relevant in this message today about those of you who are married. I almost called the message today single, sanctified, and satisfied. Yeah, I didn't expect to get much response there either. And I almost said God's word to singles and those who wish they were single. But I didn't think that would probably go over so well anyway. So God's word to singles. I want to talk to you from my heart today, singles. Some things that God's word has to say about you specifically. But before we do that, let me just help you this morning to identify that there are 3 kinds of singles. First of all, there are those who are single by creation. God just created some people to be married, and he created some people to be single. Paul talked about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7. He said, "I wish that everyone could get along without marrying just as I do." Now, because Paul says this, a lot of people think that Paul was never married. And I've had people ask me, was the Apostle Paul ever married? I personally think that he was at one time married because he was a member of the Sanhedrin. And as a member of the Sanhedrin, it was a requirement that you be married. But evidently what has happened is the Apostle Paul's wife has passed away, and passed away before they even had any children. And Paul has made a commitment that for the remainder of his life, he's going to live as a single man so that he can be more fully devoted to the kingdom of God and to the work of God. And he says that, I wish that everyone could get along without marrying just as I do. But he says, but we're not all the same. All the married people say, amen. We're not all the same. He says that God gives some the gift of a husband or wife. That is, he gives some the gift of marriage. But then others he gives the gift. Notice, this is a gift. The gift of being able to stay happily unmarried. So he's basically saying that God gave some of us a gift to remain single. God has given some of us a gift of celibacy, and to others he's given the gift of marriage. And that's what's important, is that we understand they're both a gift. It's not like one is a gift and one's not a gift. They are both a gift that God has given to us. And so some are single by creation. God just created you to be single. You're happiest single. God just created you to live an unmarried life. But then there's others that are single by circumstance. And I don't know if some of you that are here today and you're single, I don't know what your circumstances are that led to you being single. For some of you, no doubt your spouse has passed away, and since your spouse passed away, you've decided, you know what, I had the best, it don't get no better, and I'm just going to spend the rest of my life single. There are some others that are single as a result of divorce. And divorce is a very, very painful thing. I don't think anyone who has ever gone through a divorce will tell you, you know, that's the best thing that ever happened to me. You know, down the road, maybe they might feel that way, but when you're going through it, it is a very, very painful ordeal, especially if there are children involved. And Paul talked about another circumstance. He said, let's just say that there are two people, when they get married, that they're both unbelievers. And that happens quite often, that two people who are unbelievers come together, they get married. And he said, let's just suppose that after they get married, one of them ends up becoming a follower of Jesus Christ. That one of them ends up giving their heart and life to the Lord. And when they do, the other spouse is not happy about that. And the other spouse decides, well, you know what? I don't like this new person, and I don't want to live with this new person anymore, this person who's given their heart to the Lord. And So I'm going to leave. And here's what Paul said. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 7:15, he said, but if the husband or wife who isn't a believer insists on leaving, he said, let them go. In such cases, the believing husband or wife is no longer bound to the other, for God has called you to live in peace. Now, let me tell you what he is not saying. He's not saying that if two unbelievers come together and one of those unbelievers ends up becoming a believer, that the believer now has permission to go home and tell their spouse, get out. You know, I'm a follower of Christ now and you're not, so hit the road, Jack or Jill, you know. And Paul said, that is not at all what I'm saying. As a matter of fact, he goes on to clarify, and he said, listen, if one of you become a believer and the other one remains an unbeliever, and the unbeliever is fine with you being a believer, is okay with you being a believer, and wants to stay, then absolutely that marriage is supposed to stay together. So really what we're going to see here in just a few moments is that there are two biblical reasons for divorce. I have people ask me all the time, and possibly a third. But one, of course, is adultery, and Jesus was very clear about that. That adultery is grounds for divorce. Another is abandonment, as we see here where Paul's talking about that when, you know, when two unbelievers marry, one becomes a believer, the other one abandons the believer. He said, let them go. And then perhaps even in such cases as abuse. I believe in the case of abuse, what needs to happen before there's divorce is that there needs to be some separation time, and that the two parties should be given opportunity to try to work on things, to change, to work. And of course, if not, God, I don't think God wants you in an abusive environment, especially if your life is on the line and your life is being threatened. But some people are single by creation. Some are single by circumstance, one circumstance or another. And then there are some who are single by choice. And maybe there's even some of you here today as a single person, you've decided, you know what, marriage just isn't for me. Or maybe you've decided, I'm just so much in love with Jesus that I just want to devote my entire life to following him and serving him and building the kingdom of God. Jesus talked about this in Matthew chapter 19, verse 12. And this is coming out of a conversation that he's just had with his disciples. And he shared with his disciples. He told them, he said, listen, the only grounds biblically for a divorce is adultery. And when the disciples heard that, they looked at Jesus and they said, man, that's pretty risky. So you'd be better off to not marry at all if that's the only reason that you can get divorced, because these disciples are thinking, what if you marry a person and then once you're married to them for a while, you realize you don't like them? You know, you can't just leave. You can't just divorce them. And as we're gonna see in a little while, marriage is permanent. Marriage is till death do us part. And as I said in the first service today, I think some people misheard that and thought it said till debt do us part. No, not debt. Death. Marriage is permanent. And Jesus goes from that conversation to these disciples saying, well, you know what? We'd just be better off to not get married if the only way we can get out of this thing is if there is adultery. And here's what Jesus said. Jesus said, you know, some are born as eunuchs. And then he said, some have been made eunuchs by others. And some chose not to marry for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. So what is a eunuch? A eunuch is a man who has been castrated, a man whose sexual organs have been surgically removed, which many times, and even in some cultures today, if you serve in the palace as a man and you're serving royal women in the palace, you would be forced to become a eunuch because they did not want there to be any possibility of there being temptation of you having sexual relationships with the royal women in the palace. Not only that, many times the king would require that those who were closest to him would become eunuchs because he wanted their full loyalty. So he would have them to become eunuchs because he didn't want them corrupted and distracted by sexual passion and sexual temptation. And so Jesus said, some are born as eunuchs. That is, some men and women are born physically unable to have sexual relationships with the opposite sex. And then he said, not only that, he said, but some are born and just don't have that desire, that kind of passion, that kind of sexual desire. So he said, some are born eunuchs, some have been made eunuchs by others, and then others chose to be like a eunuch. That is, they've chosen not to marry because they want to be able to fully focus on their relationship with God. They want to be able to fully focus on building and expanding the kingdom of God. And so they don't want any distraction to that. So some are single by creation, some by circumstance, and some by choice. Now you already know me to know that wasn't my choice, all right? And there's some others here today that wasn't their choice. And if you've made that choice, then what a gift that is that God has given you to be able to live the remainder of your life as a single person in full pursuit of a relationship with God. Now let's face it, not everybody who chooses to be single has that kind of passion for the Lord. So Paul is not saying everybody. He's talking here to believers, right? He's talking to the believers at the church at Corinth. And he tells them a couple of things. And here's what I want us to look at for the next few minutes this morning. First of all, Paul talks to them about the blessings of a single life. You see, there's blessings in a single life and there's blessings in marriage. But Paul said, you hear a lot about marriage, but what about singles? What about the blessedness of the single life? Well, here's the first thing that Paul would say. Paul would say they're blessed because singles generally have less distress. Now, don't come after me, single folks, because I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Pastor, you've been married almost 41 years. You've forgotten what it's like to be single. But understand here, Paul's not talking about single moms or single dads. He's not talking about those who are single and have children to take care of and have children to provide for, because I'm just going to tell you this morning, man, you have my respect and you have my admiration. I can have, at this point in my life, I can have my grandchildren for a few days and I'm wiped out. So I don't know how you single parents, you single moms, you single dads, how you do everything on your plate to do, to make sure that your children are being provided for, to make sure that, you know, you gotta go to work, you've gotta make sure they get to all of their activities. And I'm telling you, man, you have my respect. I honor you. Can we just let all of our single parents here today know how much we love, honor, and respect them? But he's talking here to singles who don't have children in the mix, who don't have children in the mix here. And he said that for those single people who don't have a spouse and don't have children, they generally have less distress. And here's how he says it in 1 Corinthians 7, 25 and 26. He said, now concerning virgins, virgins would be those who have never been married. And Paul assumes that if you've not been married, you're still a virgin. How many of you know that's the way it should be? Boy, that was a weak amen. Right? Now, come on, folks. We're not here to talk today about what's acceptable in culture. We're talking here today about what's acceptable to God. And he said, now, considering virgins, those who have never been married, he said, I don't have a command from the Lord. So here's what he's saying. He said, you're not going to find this written anywhere in the Bible. You're not even going to find where Jesus said anything about this. He said, so I have no command of the Lord, but he said, I'm giving you my opinion as a single man. I'm giving you my opinion as one who by the Lord's mercy is trustworthy. In other words, he said, you should be able to believe what I'm saying today. My words should carry influence because I am trustworthy and because I'm speaking as one inspired by the Holy Spirit. And so he said, my opinion is, he said, I think that in view of the pending crisis, that it is good for you to remain as you are. And then he goes on to verses 27 and 28, and he says this. He says, are you bound to a wife? Do not seek to be free. We'll talk about that in a moment. Are you free from a wife? Do not seek a wife. But if you marry, you do not sin. And if a virgin marries, she does not sin. Yet those who marry will experience distress in the flesh. And Paul said, my heart and my desire is to spare you from that kind of distress. Now, what kind of distress is he talking about? Well, Paul goes on later to talk about how that time here on this earth is short, that Jesus is going to return soon. And he even tells us in the book of 1st and 2nd Timothy, all the things that are going to happen the closer we get to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, one of the things that's going to happen is it's going to be really dangerous for you to be a Christian. He said that there's going to be persecution. And for some of you today, you know, we don't feel so much of that here, but in other parts of the world, this is a reality. That believers in other parts of the world right now literally are putting their lives on the line for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul is saying that the closer we get to the return of Jesus Christ, the more we are going to be persecuted. Now listen, Paul knew what it was like to be persecuted. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul lists some of the things that he had encountered in his life. He said, I have been beaten. He said, I have been whipped. He said, I was stoned and left for dead. He said that I have enemies surrounding me, every one of them looking for an opportunity to take me out. He said, I have fallen victim to bandits. I've been robbed. And he said, and I also know what it's like to have both those who are unbelievers and those who are believers against me. And then he would also say this. He said, I know what it's like to wake up every single day of my life and wonder, is today my last day on this earth? And Paul said, in view of that, he said, I'm sure glad in this crisis, in this time of persecution, that I don't have a wife and I don't have children to worry about me. And then not only that, but I don't have a wife and children that I have to worry about experiencing that kind of persecution and those kinds of threats. Paul said, because I'm single with no spouse and no children, it's easier for me during this impending crisis and during this persecution to continue to fully devote myself to the Lord Jesus Christ and not worry about them threatening me and say, we're going to do this to your family if you don't do so and so. Do y'all understand how I'm tracking here? And Paul said, because of that, as a single person, I'm blessed. But not only that, he said, yet those who marry, he said, they'll experience distress in the flesh. Now, let me tell you a little bit about what he's talking about here. How many of you know that when we come together in marriage, whether you're unbelievers or whether you're believers, you're still two imperfect people? And how many of you know just trying to keep your own imperfect self in check is one great challenge? But now you bring two imperfect people together. And I'm just going to tell you right now, you don't truly know the person you're marrying until you've married them. Because when you are dating, the person you are dating is always on their best behavior. They are trying to win your love. They are trying to win you over. And they're on their best behavior. And let me just say something to you this morning. If you're dating somebody and their best behavior is still really bad behavior, you need to move on. Because if you think it's going to get better after you get married, if you think you're going to be able to change them after you get married, you can forget that. You can't even change yourself without the help of God. So can you imagine the stress of a marriage of these two imperfect people? You know, I've counseled with a lot of married couples, and I've walked with them through the process even of ending the marriage, divorce, and more times than not, I hear them say, we're divorcing because of irreconcilable differences. And you may be here this morning and you may fall into that category. Of course, we have irreconcilable differences, especially if the two coming together are unbelievers. We all have differences, and only with the help of God, only with the help of the Holy Spirit, can two imperfect people, can two different people with two different points of view come together and have a happy, productive marriage. I'm telling you, none of us could be reconcilable if it were not for the help of the Holy Spirit and the power of God's Word. That's why we've got to make sure that Christ is at the center of our marriage, that Christ is at the center of our home, and that before we have submitted to one another, we have first submitted ourselves wholly to the King of Kings and to the Lord of Lords. Amen. So you got that stress of persecution. You've got the stress of just two imperfect people trying to get to. And Paul says, when you're single, You don't have to worry about that. You just got to worry about yourself. But not only that, Paul would also say, not only do singles generally have less distress, but singles generally have less distractions. Distractions. And this was Paul's whole argument here, because Paul's like, man, now that I'm not married and I don't have any children, I can devote myself fully to following Jesus. I can devote myself fully to God. Look in 1 Corinthians 7, verse 32. Paul says this. He says, I want you to be free from anxiety. Boy, how many of you would love that? To be free of anxiety. He said, I want you to be free from anxieties. He said, the anxious man, or the unmarried man, is anxious about the affairs of the Lord, how to please the Lord. Now, again, he's talking to believers here. Because unbelievers, you know, they're not concerned with pleasing the Lord. It's still all about pleasing themselves. But he said, I want you to be free from anxieties. He said, the unmarried man is anxious about the affairs of the Lord, how to please the Lord. But then in verses 33 and 34, he says, but the married man is anxious about the affairs of the world, how to please his wife. And his interests are divided. So now you're not just trying to please God. If you're married, now you got a wife to please. I knew you guys were going to be quiet. I knew it. And Paul said that because of that, now your interests are divided. You're not able to fully devote yourself to God because you've got a wife to take care of. And he says, and not only that, but then you have children. And now you've got children that you've got to take care of. So you understand what Paul is saying here. And then he goes on and he says this in verse 34. He said, and the unmarried woman and the virgin, notice he's talking to those who are divorced. He's talking to those whose spouse who are widowed. He's talking to those who have never been married. He said, and the unmarried woman and the virgin are anxious about the affairs of the Lord so that they may be holy in body and spirit. But the married woman is anxious about the affairs of the world, how to please her husband. And then in verse 35, he says this, I say this for your benefit, not to put any restraint upon you, because he's going to say, hey, if you want to get married, get married. If you want to stay single, stay single. He said, I'm not trying to put any restraint upon you, but to promote good order. Look at this, an unhindered devotion to the Lord. So generally, those who are single with no spouse, no children, have more time to devote to the Lord, to pursue the Lord, to serve the Lord. So yes, if you're here this morning and you're single, you're blessed. Come on. You're blessed. You don't have some of the stress that married folks do, and you don't have some of the distractions that married people do. You're blessed. But what about the burdens? Because there's also the burdens of the single life. And those of you that are here this morning that are single, this is what you've been wanting me to get to right here. The burden of passion. Man, Pastor, I'd love to be single, but I've got all of this sexual passion that I just cannot control. Well, listen to what Paul says in verses 8 and 9 of 1 Corinthians 7. He said, but I say to the unmarried and to the widows, again, covering all of them, he said, it is good if they remain even as I am, that is, single, but if they cannot exercise self-control. Now, this is why Jamie married me. She just couldn't control herself around me. And I can say that today because she's not here. Yeah, but I'm sure she'll come back and watch it later. Y'all pray for me. But if they cannot exercise self-control, let them marry. So Paul is saying that that is one of the purposes. That is one of the reasons to get married, if you don't have control over your sexual passions. But let me just tell you this. He's not saying that's the only reason to get married. Neither is he saying even that that's the best reason to get married. Let me tell you the best reason to get married if you're single. If it's God's will for your life to get married, then get married. And if it's God's will for you to stay single, then stay single. Amen? But if you have a problem exercising self-control, he said it is better to marry than to, and here's where a lot of people in the sentence, than to burn. You know, making it sound like you're going to burn in hell. No, that's not what he's saying there. He's saying it's better to marry than to burn with passion. Than to burn with passion. Now, let me just say something to you singles here today who are saying, well, that's one of the reasons that I want to get married is because of this sexual passion, because of a lack of control of this sexual passion in my life. Let me tell you something. If that's the main reason you're getting married for the wrong reason. And if you think that you can come into a righteous marriage and have unrighteous desires met in that marriage, you're wrong. Because the Bible is clear in the book of Hebrews that the marriage bed is undefiled. That means it's to be a place of righteousness. And it is to be a place of holiness. And nothing and no one else is to enter into that space but you and your spouse. And if you think for one moment that unrighteous sexual temptation is going to go away when you get married, you're wrong. And any married person, pretty much any married person in this room here today will tell you, listen, if you're struggling with pornography as a single person, you're going to struggle with pornography when you get married. And what you've got to do is you've got to allow the power of the Holy Spirit to change your heart and set you free from those unrighteous desires that you have. God help me this morning. Amen. I shared a little bit with the choir and the music team this past Wednesday night, and I talked about how important it is that we have a holy heart and that we live a life of holiness. And I told him, I said, now I'm gonna go old school and old time on you here. And on the way home that night, the Holy Spirit of the Lord corrected me and said, Victor Massey, you need to remember that holiness is not just for the old time. That holiness is as relevant today as it's ever been before. That I am still a holy, holy, holy God. Amen. Notice what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 4:3. He said, for this is the will of God. Some of you singles and married folk that want to know what the will of God is, here's a good bit about what the will of God is. He said, this is the will of God, your sanctification. God has not called us to impurity. God has called us to sanctification, to holiness. And he says that you should abstain from sexual immorality. Being single is not a license to be immoral. Listen to me, I know it's a struggle. But with the help of God, with the help of the Holy Spirit, you can stay pure. You can. And Paul even goes on in verses 4 and 5, and he says, each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the pagans who do not know God. In other words, if we are followers of Christ, if we are believers, we don't live like unbelievers. We don't live like pagans. We don't live like we don't know who God is and what God requires of us. And then Paul goes on in verse 8 and he says this. He said, therefore, whoever rejects these words does not reject man. Listen, if you reject what I'm saying here this morning, you're not rejecting me. You're rejecting God. You're rejecting God's plan, God's purpose for your life. Look at this. Who has also given us his Holy Spirit. God wants you to know that the power that you need to live an overcoming, sanctified, purified life is available to you through the power and the presence and the person of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And let me just tell you how serious the Holy Spirit is. 1 Corinthians 5 and 11. He said, I've written to you to not keep company with anyone named a brother or a sister. That is somebody who professes to be a Christian, someone who professes to be a follower of Christ. He said, if they profess to be a believer, if they profess to be a follower of Christ and they're sexually immoral, it just doesn't line up with God's word. It just doesn't line up with his will. And he said, I've written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral or covetous or an idolater or a reviler or a drunkard or an extortioner, not to even eat with such a person. Why? Because when we come to God, we fully surrender to him, our body, our soul, and our spirit. And we take off the old clothes and the old life, and we put on the new clothes and the new life. And Paul said it like this in 2 Timothy 2:21. He said, if you keep yourself pure, listen to me, this is so important. If you keep yourself pure, you will be a utensil that God can use for his purpose. And I know every single person in this room here today, you want to be used for God's purpose. And then he said, your life will be clean and you will be ready for the master to use you for every good work. Now listen, he didn't say perfect, but he did say pure. It's the burden of passion. And then there's the burden of pain. And the team's going to come and help me try to wind this up, and then I'm going to try to get out of here alive. But the burden of pain. Let me tell you the pain that most singles feel more than any. Even if they're single by choice, they still have seasons of loneliness. And how many of you know that lonely is painful? I mean, you want somebody that you can share life with and spend life with. The psalmist said it like this in Psalm 25 and 16. He said, turn to me, God, and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. And some of you today, like I said, even though you're single by choice, there's still seasons that you have when you're lonely. We all need community. We all need other people in our lives. But notice, he wasn't just lonely, he was also afflicted. And some of you today, you're not single by choice, but you're single by circumstances. And maybe something very painful happened in your marriage that led to a divorce. Maybe it was adultery, maybe it was abandonment, maybe it was abuse, whatever. And now you're still living with the pain of that. You're still living, some of you even with open wounds as a result of that hurt that you experienced. And so now you're in a place where you just don't trust. And it's not that you're not remarrying because you don't want to. It's because you're just like, I ain't putting myself in that kind of a situation again. I'm not going to put myself out there to be hurt like that again. But how many of you know that not only can the Holy Spirit of God give us the power to live a sanctified life, but he also has the power to heal a hurting life. And he can heal you this morning. And I can promise you this, that what God can do is he can heal you in such a way that you were better than you were before it ever happened. God can put you back into a relationship. If that's your desire, you may choose to remain single, that's fine. But God can put you back in a relationship today with a man who loves you, or with a woman who loves you, who honors you, who respects you, and treats you the way that God created you to be treated. Come on, somebody. Somebody that values you. Somebody that honors you. So there's that burden of passion. There's the burden of patience. And then there's the burden of pain. And then there's the burden of patience. That's where some of you are today. You're like, man, Pastor, I've been waiting and I've been waiting And I've been waiting because I know what God said in Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. God said that it's not good for the man or the woman to be alone, so I'm going to make a helper comparable to him. And you're like, Pastor, I've been waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting for my helper. Well, let me tell you what the helper is here. Because when you see that word helper, you just think, well, God's got somebody out there that's going to help me be who I need to be and do what God's called me to do. No, the word helper there means to complete or to make whole. I often tell Jamie, honey, you're my rib. Because when God created Eve, he took the rib out of Adam. And I told her, I said, you what's been missing in my life? Woo! Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You complete me. You make me whole. You give me a perspective on things that I didn't have before you came into my life. But it's so important that we be patient. And not like Abraham and Sarah and begin to take things into our own hands and make a mess out of stuff. Because you remember what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 6:14. He said, do not be yoked together with unbelievers, for what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? And he goes on in verse 14 and says, what harmony is there between Christ and Belial? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? And you're like, Pastor, I know exactly what God says, and I've been looking, I've been waiting on a believer, and it just hasn't happened. So now I'll just take anybody. I just need somebody. And you'll get yourself in a situation that you wish you could get out of and you can't. And that's why Paul said this in 1 Corinthians 7, verse 39. He said, a woman is bound to her husband as long as he lives. Now listen, that means marriage is permanent. Till death do us part. Think about that. But if her husband dies or if his wife dies, they are free to marry anyone they wish. But look at this. They must belong to the Lord. That's the key. And listen to me. I know you feel like you've been waiting, but the appointed time is near. I really sense that for some of our singles in this room today. For some of you, listen to me. This is the last Valentine's Day you will spend alone. I speak that over you this morning. I'm going to ask you to stand with me all over this room. I'm going to ask every single in the room. You're like, but Pastor, I've been coming to this church and hiding. Nobody knows I'm single. I want to keep it that way. No, every single person in the room today, would you come and just join me here at the front of this building? Every single person. That's it. Come on. Church, can we give it up for this incredible group of folks here today? Come on in, come on in, make room, we got more. Make room, just make room. Might have to move over this direction a little bit. Hallelujah. Prayer team, I want you just to gather in behind them and just support us in prayer today. First of all, I would say to every single person in this room here today, I would ask you, have you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Some of you are like, well, Pastor, you know, I am in this season of waiting, but what do I do while I wait? Well, you don't just do nothing. But what you do is what we've been talking about all year. You keep moving forward. I mean, because what a wonderful season this is for you to have the time that you have right now to move closer to Christ, to use this time wisely, to get to know Christ better, to get closer to Him. But not only that, to move into community. I love it when I leave here on Sunday and I see some of you young men, you young ladies, you single folks, you're getting together, you're going to lunch together, you're building community with one another. That is so important. And then you keep moving forward toward your calling. Let me tell you one thing you need to be absolutely sure of before you get into marriage. You need to know who you are, and you need to know what God's call is on your life. Amen. Your future spouse deserves that. And here's what I believe will happen. As you keep moving forward towards Christ, towards community, and towards your calling, on that journey along the way, you're going to bump into a young lady. You're going to bump into a young woman or a young man, and you're going to be like, "Woo, baby. You just what I've been waiting on, and you were worth the wait." Hallelujah. So if you don't know Jesus this morning, that's where you got to start. You got to surrender your life to him. And then when God brings that person into your life, you make sure they've surrendered. And then together, before you get married, you surrender that marriage to God. So I want you just to lift up your hands. Rest of the church, I want you just to stretch your hands in this direction. First of all, I want every one of you to know I love you. I thank God for you. And I want you to know that even though you may not be able to see it right now, God is moving and God is working on your behalf, that God hears and God answers prayer. Father, I pray over every one of these single young men and single young ladies here today, God. Every one of these single men and women gathered here at the front of this building today, Father God, you know more than just the cry that comes from their mouth. You know the cry that comes from their heart, Lord. Some of them, Lord, are fine. Some of them are good and feel called to a single life. And what a gift that is, Lord, that they've got that kind of time that they can fully devote to pursuing you and to expanding your kingdom. But God, there's others of these single men and women here today who desire a spouse, who desire someone to spend the rest of their life with, Lord. And so, Lord, I know that you're hearing the desire of their heart. And God, your desire for them is the same, that you want them to have that special, significant someone that they can spend the rest of their life with. But because they're your child, because they are special, you are picky, God, and you want to make sure that they have someone that is filled with your Holy Spirit, someone who, like them, wants to pursue Christ, wants to help build the kingdom of God and do it together as a married couple. Father, I pray right now that they would take the burdens that they have and they would lay them at the foot of the cross today. The burden of passion, Lord. The burden of pain. The burden of patience, Lord. That they would cast all their cares, cast their burdens on you, God, because we know you care for them. Each and every one of them, you care for them. And God, I do declare over many of them today, this will be the last Valentine's Day they are alone. God, you're about to work, and you're about to work quickly, and you're about to work in a way that is greater, exceedingly, abundantly above all that they could have ever asked or imagined, Lord. Hallelujah. May your blessings be on them today, Lord, as they already are. And God, those that don't know you as Lord and Savior, I pray that right where they stand right now, they'll say, "Lord, forgive me of my sins. I confess to you today that I'm a sinner and that I need your help, Lord. And I ask you today to receive me into your family. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that he died on the cross for my sins. I believe that he rose again. And I believe that he can give me the strength and the power that I need to live a holy, sanctified life from now until he returns. So today, Jesus, I'm yours. I'm yours. I'm yours. Hallelujah. Come on, let's just thank God today. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Listen, if you just prayed that prayer to accept the Lord, please come see us back at Connection Cafe. We've got some materials we want to put in your hands, and we want to rejoice with you today over that decision that you've made. Amen. Amen. Don't spend Valentine's Day alone. You see these other young ladies and men here, y'all get together. Have the best Valentine's Day you've ever had. Amen.